Labor is, in the first place, a process in which both man and nature participate, and in which man, of his own accord, starts, regulates, and controls the material reactions between himself and nature. He opposes himself to nature as one of her own forces, setting in motion arms and legs, heads and hands, the natural forces of his body, in order to appropriate nature's productions in a form adapted to his own wants. By thus acting on the external world and changing it, he at the same time changes his own nature. We begin this chapter with a discussion on labour and its relationship between humans and nature. In this section, Marx is not writing about any specific type of labour processes, but labour in the abstract, general labour or humans' ability to perform labour, produce use values, and shape the world around them. Marx sees that humans are a natural product, or a force of nature, that also oppose themselves against nature to shape it to their own desire. While we're a part of the natural world, we also see the world as a natural gift to us, a natural supply of tools and materials, and it's with these gifts that we shape nature to our own wants. But in shaping and changing the world to our own desire, it becomes reflected back upon us, shaping and changing our nature as a human, changing the way we view the world and our ideas, which we then again use to change the nature around us. The material world around us gives and shapes our ideas. We look at things in the world, form our own opinions about them, both individually and as a society or culture. We imagine how they could be different and form ideas on how to change them. And then with these ideas, we alter the material world around us through labour processes. This new, altered material world then gives us yet again new ideas, which we again use to shape and change the material world through labour, and so on and so on. So while humans may alter the natural world with their labouring, they are still very much inside of nature, not outside. In this sense, human nature, or what is natural to humans, isn't something that is fixed, or in fact doesn't exist at all. It shifts and changes as a reflection dependent on the past labouring processes and ideas that have shaped the material world that we currently inhabit. Marx sees that as well as a desire for joy, relaxation, and contemplation, something that is fundamental to humans, an essence to our species, is our ability to labour, our ability to transform the world we live in. Labour is a universal trait of humankind that has always existed in all forms of social relationships and modes of production throughout human history. But what distinguishes the worst architect from the best of these is that the architect builds the cell in his mind before he constructs it in wax. While Marx acknowledges that animals perform labour, he argues that their labour is essentially nature that is not working against itself. Animals don't first think of the idea to change the world around them, they just perform specific labour processes that are constrained to their natural environments. They produce nothing new, only producing what they directly need, and so are frozen or fixed within nature. Marx states that they produce one-sidedly, while humans produce universally. That is, animals produce only under the dominion of their immediate physical needs. Humans, on the other hand, produce even when free from that physical need, and it's because of this that human labour only truly produces in freedom. Living labour must seize upon these things, awaken them from the dead, change them from merely possible into real and effective use values. Bathed in the fire of labour, appropriated as part of its organism, and infused with vital energy. Marx argues that labour processes contain three elements: the worker, their tools, and the materials they are working upon. The worker is active. Their tools and the materials they work on, what Marx calls the means of production, are passive. They are parts of nature that become an extension of the worker's mind and body. In this, the activity of labour, or work, is the transformation of nature into the image of the human, or the translation of human ideas into physical objects. It's the bringing of life to the dead. Use values become the embodiment of the human will, and are only ever the result of human labour. They don't exist externally to humans, but only as things we have created for ourselves and created within certain social conditions. Labour uses up its material factors, its subject and its instruments, consumes them, and is therefore a process of consumption. Such productive consumption is distinguished from individual consumption by this, that the latter uses up products as means of subsistence for the living individual, the former as means whereby alone labour, the labour power of the living individual, is enabled to act. The product, therefore, of individual consumption is the consumer himself. The result of productive consumption is a product distinct from the consumer. Marx now writes about the process of consumption, that is, the consuming of commodities and their value. Firstly, distinguishing individual consumption. We will approach this topic again in further chapters, but for now, Marx here is discussing the consumption of use values that the labourer takes part in. For the labourer, the individual consumption of commodities is for their own subsistence. We eat the apple when we're hungry. We wear a hat to keep the sun off our face. We kick our football for enjoyment. At the end of these processes, the use value is realised. The commodities and their values are eventually consumed. Within the labour process, however, Marx secondly distinguishes productive consumption. Here, the labourer consumes commodities, but within the context of the production of new commodities. Cotton is consumed in the making of a hat. Sand is consumed in the making of glass. Leather in the production of footballs. Individual consumption is our direct consumption of commodities to sustain our own lives and maintain our labour power. Productive consumption is the consumption of commodities within the labour process in the production of new commodities and new use values. What is interesting to note is that individual consumption is always the result of productive consumption. We can't, for example, individually consume or wear our hat until it has been made, and so it has to go through the process of productive consumption of other commodities, cotton and plastic, before we can do so. In this sense, labour consumes products in order to create products, or in other words, consumes one set of products by turning them into the means of production for another set. The labour process, resolved into the simple elementary factors, is human action with a view to the production of use values, appropriation of natural substance to human requirements. It is the necessary condition for effecting exchange of matter between man and nature. It is the everlasting nature-imposed condition of human existence. The general character of the labour process is evidently not changed by the fact that the worker works for the capitalist instead of for himself. Moreover, the particular methods and operations employed are not immediately altered. The transformation of the mode of production itself, which results from the subordination of labour to capital, can only occur later on. Marx now briefly discusses an immediate distinction of labour under the capitalist mode of production, noting that the capitalist firstly must purchase two things from the market: labour power, the worker's ability to perform labour, and the means of production, both the tools and materials that the commodity is produced with. In later chapters, Marx will expand these processes and how they function in the capitalist system as a whole, but for now we can observe two things under this relationship. Firstly, that the commodity of labour power sold by the worker is consumed by the capitalist. It no longer belongs to the labourer. The techniques and hows and whys of labour as a creative force no longer belong to the worker. The decisions are now made for them instead, as the labour power now becomes an extension of the capitalists in its consumption. Secondly, the means of production, the tools and materials, do not belong to the labourer either, and so, by extension, the commodity that's produced also doesn't belong to the labourer. Under this relationship, the whole labour process becomes separated from the worker. Their species essence becomes alienated from them, as the worker is no longer able to interact with their own ideas and their own labour to shape their world around them. work for the laborer is no longer the autonomous means of self-expression and fulfillment, but is rather an alien force that's imposed upon them, dominating them. Marx doesn't go into too much detail on alienation throughout Capital, but his previous works, The Economic and Philosophical Manuscripts of 1844, analyzes this concept of alienation and its effect on human health, behavior, and relationships in much greater detail. I'd highly recommend reading it if you haven't. It's fairly short and the concepts in it are something that you should continually think about as you read further on through Capital. I'll provide a link below for anyone who is interested in doing so.